Hi, I'm Hannah Bernard. You're watching Market 1 Minute, and I'm here today with Lee Buckler of RepliCel Life Sciences. So Lee, the company has been around in its current form since 2010, but you've been recently talking about a bit of a turnaround story almost in the biotech sector about RepliCel. Tell us why.
Well, I think, you know, it's an exciting, in a way, a turnaround, and in a way, just an exciting timing for the company, because this is a company, as you can expect, in biotech, it takes a long time to ramp up. We spent 10 years translating the basic science of the company into four products that we sit with today. In 2016, we made some tough decisions, but it restructured the company, refocused the company, refinanced the company, and we now sit with three clinical readouts this quarter in a company that's had one clinical readout in the past decade, an opportunity to do more licensing, leveraging on the one licensing deal we have with Shiseido, to a year where we're going to have three clinical readouts this quarter. We've just raised $7 million in the past 5 months. We have the device being manufactured and tested this year, positioned for market launch and a deal next year. We're chasing non-dilutive capital and looking at an opportunity to uplist on more senior exchanges on both sides of the border as soon as it makes sense.
And the company was founded on the science for this potential treatment for pattern baldness. So you've recently released data on it. So tell us about that and what it means for shareholders and potential investors.
Right. So we're excited about this product. I mean, you know, there's an incredible consumer demand for better solutions for thinning hair and hair loss in both men and women. We published data in a human clinical trial in 2012 that was 6 months post-injection. We've followed up those patients for 5 years now and studied the safety profile of the product. And this was a high dose of injection of cells, looking really to test the limits of whether there was any safety concerns with an injection of cells in the short term or long term. Mm-hmm. And the good news is we found absolutely no concerns 5 years in following these patients up. But more importantly, we saw a wide variety of hair density responses, including a segment of patients that responded very well, and their response maintained through 24 months. So our job now is to take that pocket of responders, take the maturation of the product that we've been pursuing since we originally launched that trial. Mm-hmm. We have what we think is now a more robust product. We can pursue multiple injections of the product. We can pursue different doses of the product that we think will lead to better results, and really drive this into next phase clinical development, where we expect to see higher density results amongst a wider variety of participants.
It's exciting. So let's talk about the other products in your portfolio. You have products that are focusing on chronic tendon injury and anti-aging of the skin. What's the status with those, and what should shareholders be aware of?
Yeah, so you know, as you may recall, the whole basis of the company's science is figuring out how to take patients' populations of cells that we understand a particular function of and manufacture a product that gets re-injected back into the patient locally, to have a local effect where the existing cells aren't accomplishing what they maybe otherwise accomplished when you were younger. Mm-hmm. And so we have another cell population, a fibroblast cell population, that's highly expressive of type 1 collagen. Type 1 collagen is one of the critical proteins responsible for the maintenance of young-looking skin and functioning tendons. So we have some very exciting predicate data showing the ability of an injection of fibroblasts to treat people with chronically degenerated tendons of the ankle, tennis elbow, golfer's elbow, jumper's knee, and regenerate the tendon. You can visually see it by ultrasound, but also to get them back functioning and elimination of pain. We threw that into a clinical trial at the Sports Medicine Clinic here at UBC, and are about to get the clinical data from that trial in the next week or so. Very excited to see that data. It's that same population that we also put into a dermatology study in Germany for the rejuvenation of aging and sun-damaged skin, and expect again to see that data in the next couple of weeks.
Well, there's so much going on with RepliCel Life Sciences in addition to this device that is your nearest term commercial asset. Where are things at with that?
So as you'll recall, you know, we became convinced that it was absolutely critical to come up with a next generation dermal injector that brought unparalleled precision and control to things that you want to inject into the skin, ultimately for the injection of our cells, but in the short term for the injection of the $2 billion worth of products which are injected into skin today. Yeah. We're manufacturing and testing the commercial grade prototypes of that device this year, and anticipate getting it on the market in Europe and in the hands of a licensing partner next year, such that we're aggressively shooting for this year potentially to be the last pre-revenue year for RepliCel Life Sciences.
So many catalysts materializing in Q1. What can investors look forward to for the rest of 2017?
So it's a great question. Obviously, we haven't locked the development pathway for our products up until we see this data. But we have the three clinical readouts this quarter. The hair we've just announced, the tendon and skin are coming up shortly. We're going to take all that data, sit around with our clinical advisors, and really develop a strategy for optimizing the clinical development of these products in a way which delivers maximum shareholder value over the next 18 months.
It sounds like the time is now, Lee. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thanks, Anna.